I'm glad everybody's not sugar, so there must be some that think they are, you know, that if you get out in the rain, you're going to melt. But we're glad you're here, no matter how sweet you are, so just to come to this place to be with the Lord this morning. And a couple of quick announcements. First one, next Sunday after church, we're going to ask whoever is physically capable of doing so to kind of hang around and help us carry all of the things upstairs for the rummage sale and all that. There's a lot of it downstairs, and then that gives Randy all week to sort it and lay it out and mark it and all those things, but it's more than he can carry. So just immediately after church, we'll just start carrying all that stuff up. Also, start thinking about bringing in cookies and water for the hospitality part of all of it, as we provide those things for people that need a rest and all of that. We also are starting a kids' Sunday school downstairs in the whatever it's called, the room with the big sofas and couches and the big TV and all that sort of stuff. And it'll run start at 9 o'clock, just like the adults do. But it'll be downstairs and geared for kids. And it'll be a little bit different than the things that they do in children's church downstairs. So, and also, I want to thank everybody that helped physically with serving, cleaning up, and all of those things for Brenda's funeral, and for those that brought in food items and all those things. But there's something that we may need to do. Of course, we all know what Brenda's financial things and all that were like. But the way I understand it, there's a couple of different kinds of Medicaid. One of them pretty well covers everything, and the other one doesn't. She was on the other one. And so they're waiting right now to see what kind of cost and what kind of things. So if it looks like that, and there is a GoFundMe page going, but what we thought we'd do is we would wait, and they're trying to wait. They've applied for the other one, trying to see what they can get covered through all of those kind of things. And then if we need to, we will actually take up a special offering on Sunday. We'll announce it a week before so that everybody knows that it's coming. And then that'll be a way to help with Brenda's costs and all the things that were wrapped up around that. Do we have any other announcements this morning? All right, then let's set our hearts towards praising the Lord.
blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name. Blessed be your name. When the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. On a road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name.
Do you believe in God?
I believe in God, Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's Son, our Lord. He was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and came to the grave.
Do you believe that Jesus is alive? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit as the third part of the Trinity. I believe in the Spirit's work in the church.
Do you believe in one church?
I believe in the one universal church, of which the United Methodist Church is the vital living part. I believe in the unity of all people of the church as the family of God.
Do you believe in the forgiveness of sins? Let's pray. Father, we praise you and thank you, for you are without beginning and without end. Through Christ, you created the whole world, and through the Holy Spirit, you sustain it. You made the day for works of light, and the night for the refreshment of our minds and bodies. Keep us now in Christ. Stir us in us a desire to serve you, a desire to live peacefully with one another, a desire to walk closer with you, a desire to know you better. We devote this time to worship you. We devote the rest of this week to being faithful witnesses of your love and grace to others. Bless us as we come to be filled by the Spirit and to worship in Christ, in whose name we gather and pray. Amen. You may be seated. And the children can come up. I got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart. Down in my heart. I got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart to stay. A few weeks ago, probably a couple months ago, we talked about Henrietta the hen. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And about the fire, and when it was all over, there was Henrietta sitting on her eggs, taking care of those eggs that were going to become her children. Well, one of those was a boy, and what do we call boy chickens? Nobody knows? How about a rooster? Oh, yeah. And she named me Rocky, Rocky the Rooster. And Rocky began to grow up, and then he came a time he was the only rooster in the pen. So it became his job all of a sudden to be the rooster that wakes everybody up. Because roosters, they go out and they get up way before dawn, and they watch for the first time as the sun's coming up and the rays start to shine out and off through the sky, and they see that sun just starting to peek over the horizon. And what's a rooster start to do? There you go, cock-a-doodle-doo. And every morning he would cry out, cock-a-doodle-doo, and wake up the horses and the cows and the pigs and all the other chickens and all that sort of thing. And so he was really proud of that. And every morning he got up and waited for that sun so he could say, the sun is here. And it's time for everybody to get going. But then one day, it was a day about like today. It was cloudy. It was dark. The clouds were really thick. And he kept watching for the sun. And even though it started to get a little bit lighter outside, as every minute passed, he never saw the sun. And he kept looking, and finally he got worried, and he went and he told Henrietta. He got her up and he said, Mom, I don't see the sun. I've been watching for it and I don't see it. And she told him, said, it's behind the clouds. And even though it's got dark outside, the clouds are darkened and you don't see the sun, does that mean it's not there? The light's coming up, and that light that's shining through even all those dark things tells us that the sun's still there. So he runs back out, gets back up on top of the chicken coop, and even though he can't see the sun, what's he start to do?
Cock-a-doodle-doo.
And actually, even more, because he was so sure that the sun was out there, even though he couldn't see it, he wanted everybody else to be sure. So he just kept cock-a-doodle-dooing and louder till everybody was up. And you know, that's the way it is sometimes with God. Sometimes we see him really bright and we can see the things he's doing, but other times we have days that are kind of dark and with bad things are going on and we don't see God, and we wonder, is he there? Because we can't see him. But just like the sun, now you know the sun's out there, just like today, it's raining, or it was just a few minutes ago. Does that mean the sun's not shining because you can't see it? Nope. How do you know the sun's shining?
Because there's light.
Because there's light. You can see all the things around it. You may not see the sun, but you can see what the sun's doing. And that's the way it is with God. Even though we don't see him, his light still shines through, no matter how dark it is, no matter how bad things may be, or like out there, no matter how thick the clouds may be, God still shines through. So it just kind of reminds us on days like this, when we can't see the sun, but we know it's still there, that even though we may not see God, and things get kind of dark in our life, we know he's still there. And so if you know he's still there, what do you think you're supposed to be doing? What was Rocky doing?
Cock-a-doodle-doo.
Yeah, he was saying, the sun is here. Cock-a-doodle-doo, the sun's here. It's the time for everybody to get up and take notice. And that's what we do, even though, especially when we can't see God, is we need to be telling everybody, God is here. And doing it with confidence and or being sure about it so that everybody else believes us. Because if we don't believe it, when we try to tell other people, they're not. But Rocky was so sure, and that's the way we need to be, that you can tell God's here because we see his light, just like we see the light of the sun. So you all go downstairs and see what you can learn down there.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, I'd like a flower.
On our prayer list this morning, of course, we still want to remember Brenda's family and especially Carolyn and all the rest. But also, don't forget about the Beech Grove Church and what they're going through. I did communicate with Elaine yesterday. Steve's brother is a whole lot better. Things took a turn for a lot better. He was in a coma and all that to begin with, but Friday, they were putting a defibrillator in him, and then yesterday, he was supposed to be going home, and I haven't heard from her last night or today, so she wanted to make sure everybody knows that they really appreciate the prayers, and they believe that the prayers made a difference, because the way things looked in the beginning and how they turned out, and being home in just a few days was really good. Who else do we need to lift up today?
Diane
Lowe's fell, and so remember her, and then also Dorothy, who's still recovering down there, and the others that are shut in. All right, well, let's join our voices. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you for this place we have to gather in, that we can come together, join our hearts and our spirits as we pray for all these people, the ones that are on our list, Lord, the ones that were mentioned this morning, the ones that are on our hearts and maybe weren't mentioned. We pray for all those that are grieving through these days, that they will know your peace and your comfort through it all. And Lord, we pray for our congregation. We're all just sinners saved by grace. Lord, that you help us to walk with you. And even though we don't have anything to offer but brokenness and strife, we know you can take it and make it beautiful. And Lord, so we look to you and we pray for one another. We pray for those that couldn't be here today. And Lord, we also lift up our community, that you help us to be the shining light into this community around us, to make a difference, to touch lives. And Lord, we're just thankful that we can do this in your name. We pray for our nation, its leaders, Lord, and for all the things that are going on. Lord, we pray for the soldiers and their families. And Lord, we just pray for all that we have to do, that your will be done. And we just ask that you guide us, each and every one, guide us as a congregation, and guide us as your church. And all these things we say in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we ask our ushers to come forward. Let's pray. Lord, let our congregation be a witness to your love and grace. As we give our offering on this day, may we be immersed in Scripture, constant in prayer, joyful in worship, generous in giving, a loving, supportive community, reaching out to those in need. Accept this, we offer, in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I'm going to read for you today and speak to you about 1 Timothy chapter 6, starting with verse 6. But godliness with content is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world, and we could take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. People who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. But you flee from all of this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses, in the sight of God who gives life to everything, and of Christ Jesus, who while testifying before Pontius Pilate made the good confession. I charge you to keep this command without spot or blame until the appearing of our Lord Jesus. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do so, and to be good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. And in this way, they lay up treasures for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. You know, one of the things that's been obvious throughout all of mankind is some people have and some people don't have. There's no real reasoning for it or something that we can put our finger on, but that's just the way that it is. Jesus even said, you know, you will always have the poor among you. And that doesn't mean, though, that anybody's of even more worth than others. And that there are some definite instructions to both. Now some people think that the Bible denigrates or puts down people that have money. Other people think it's put down people that have poor. It kind of sometimes depends on which side of that you're on, or that one's being rewarded or one's being punished, and none of those things are true. You know, a lot of our situation depends on a lot of things besides ourselves. Sometimes we can help what we are, and sometimes we cannot. But when we look back through the Bible, you know, God uses people of both sides and of both ways. There, you know, when we look back at one of the greatest men of the Old Testament, Abraham was one of the richest men that ever lived. He had so much stuff and so many people that he had enough servants to form an army. And we read about it, that he took from his servants, made an army, and pursued five kings to overcome them to be able to bring Lot back, his nephew that had been captured and carried off. That's a lot of wealth. And there were others. Solomon was considered to be the richest man in the world in his day. And it even tells us that, you know, that there was so much wealth even in Jerusalem that people drank out of silver goblets and considered them not any different than drinking out of clay ones. It was that common and things. But then there were others that had almost nothing. You know, Elijah and some of the prophets, John the Baptist, that, you know, didn't have anything but a camel's coat, and he ate grasshoppers and honey. And, you know, it doesn't get a whole lot more destitute than that. But, and so how do we reconcile these things, and what is here? God gives some definite instructions about some of those things. And as we read out of Timothy, you know, and this is Paul writing to the young Timothy. Timothy was a man that had traveled with Paul, that Paul was there when he accepted Christ, and he actually even referred back to that part of what I read here. He's reminding Timothy of the faith that he had at his first confession of Christ and all of that and what that meant, and to stand in that faith. But Timothy was also a man that now Paul is sending off to take a church and to be a young minister. And he's trying to give him instructions, not just on how to live his life, but how to instruct others to lead their lives, what's important and what isn't. And Paul's writing this knowing that his days are almost over. And so he's wanting to get these important things out to Timothy. And he has this verse in here that gets quoted a lot that we read a little bit, and it talks about the root of all evil. And the root of all evil is what? No. Yeah, that's what gets misquoted. And it's always money is the root of all evil. Well, that's not what it says. It's wrong on two parts. It says the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Because when we say it the way that some people do, it's like everything is dependent upon money. Now, there's a lot of it, and Paul says all kinds of evil, so there's a lot of things out there, but that's not what drives it. Sometimes it's hatred and jealousy, and there's a lot of other things like that cause evil. But here, he's saying that greed, when you take and put money as your number one focus, it leads you into evil. Now, he's not saying here, he doesn't ever once in this passage does he ever criticize those that are going out to make a dollar or to make $5 or to make $10. What he's saying is, where is your focus? What's the number one thing in your life? Is it serving God and pursuing those things, or is it I have to get ahead no matter what? And putting God second or third or fourth or fifth, or maybe not even on the list at all, and then your whole desire is, what can I get? Because when you do those things, what he says is, when you have that kind of desire, then it leads you away from the Lord. And he says, that, a couple of things. Number one, he says you take a chance on losing what you have. But the other one is, he says you bring on all kinds of problems for yourself. Because for one thing, you're going it alone. And, you know, people that have that kind of focus, they don't worry about anything else. And then actually, sometimes they do get into evil, and they pursue things that they shouldn't be pursuing. Now, and that's what the focus of this is about. It's not about pursuing wealth or having something or having something that somebody doesn't. It's about making that first in your life. Making that your idol, so to speak, the thing you worship, the thing you live for, the thing that every day it consumes you. How can I get more? How can I get more? Or what happens a lot is not even that, but if I can just get this, I'll be happy. Well, if we get there and then we're not happy, but I just need this much more. I can be happy. If I get another raise, or if I can buy another car, or if I can get the right kind of, I'll be happy. If I can just. And you know what happens? It never gets there. It's if I can, because that's not what makes us content. It's not what makes us happy. It's not what does anything. Paul says here that he says, you know, and it's actually a quote from Job. He came into this world with, Job actually says, naked I came into this world, naked I'm going to leave. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And he's saying, you know, and Job had a lot. Job was also a very rich man and had thousands of different kinds of animals and finances and all of those things. But he said, you know, same thing that Paul says here. You can't take it with you. He said, so Paul says, be content with what you have. You know, he's not saying I'll get it out. He's not saying that you can't pursue those things. He said, be content. Then what you have is a reward. It's a benefit. It's something that brings joy, because if you're not content with what you have, then you never have peace. You never have joy. You never have any of those things. And Paul says, he says, we're happy with food and clothes. Now, how many of you in here be happy with food and clothes? You know, and that's Paul saying, I'm content. And Paul was a man of trade. Paul was a man that probably, being a Pharisee and all of that in Jerusalem before he was called into the service of the Lord, he was probably one of the wealthier people in town. He gave that all up. Now, he's not calling everybody else to give that up, but he's saying, I'm okay with it. And he was. That's the way he traveled around. And a lot of times that's all that he had. And there were times like we studied about last Sunday night in our Sunday night Bible study, that he was a tent maker by trade. And there were times that in his ministry, he stopped and he worked in order to have money to continue on. But, you know, it's what he's telling here, because a lot of times what we have a tendency to do is one of two things. We take the Jewish line of what was going on in Jesus' day like that and saying, if somebody has and somebody hasn't, that's not good grammar. Somebody has and possesses and has nice things, and somebody isn't as fortunate and they don't have anything at all. The Jewish thought in the New Testament was God is blessing this person, and God is not blessing this person. He is punishing them for some reason because they don't have. And we don't. What Paul is saying here is that God gives all in different ways, and that is not an indication of whether God likes you or not, how big your bank account is or how nice your house is. And sometimes we get blessed by God and we have those things, but because one person has a nice house or a nice car or whatever, and this person doesn't, it doesn't mean God favors this person and he doesn't like this one. That it just sometimes is our lot in life. But what the view that we have today is that you know, there are ministries out there that are called health and wealth ministries. This is one thing, is if you're sick or you have problems like that, then your faith isn't strong enough. That's the health part. But they also say that, you know, If you got bills to pay and you're struggling, or you know, it's just kind of been a rough life, that there's something wrong with your faith. That God doesn't intend for you to be that way. That God expects you to be healthy and wealthy and all those things. And so the problem is with you, not with God. And that is not the case at all. And there's some ministers that have built big ministries all on that health and wealth idea. But that's not what Jesus says. And that's not what it's about. And I've heard people say that Jesus criticizes rich people because of some of the things that he says. But the only time he criticizes rich people, and I'll give you a couple of examples, is when they're putting their wealth first. I usually get my scriptures from what's called the lectionary. It's a three-year cycle of scriptures, a New Testament, an Old Testament, a gospel, and a psalm. And they come like that. They're set out. A lot of churches use them. And we're actually going to start something like that after the first of the year. But on those four readings, of course, this one is the New Testament. The gospel reading today is about the rich man and Lazarus. You know, if you know that story, you know, Lazarus was a man who was laying at the gate of the rich man. He had open sores that the dogs would lick. All he wanted was the crumbs, the leftovers, the things that fell off the table from the rich man. And he didn't get them. They both died in the story about the same time. The rich man goes to hell and is going through all that, and Lazarus goes to heaven. And the conversation, the rest of the story is about a conversation between the rich man and Abraham, and about all those things. And so some people say, well, Jesus is, you know, because he's the rich man. He doesn't. Well, the problem was not his wealth. The problem was his attitude. Here is a man laying out at his gate who has no food, who is sick, who is dying, which, you know what that means? If he's at the gate, every time he came into his house, every time he left his house, he walked right past that person that he could have given him his leftovers and probably made a difference. And he didn't. And that's the problem there. The other one is, you know, Paul says, don't put your hope in your riches. Don't think that that's what's going to not only just save you, but that's what's going to get you through, or that's where your focus needs to be. And Jesus tells the story of a farmer. And this farmer was a very successful farmer, had huge grain bins, but he was so successful that his grain bins weren't big enough. And so he's laying in bed thinking, I know what I need to do. Because I'm such a good farmer and I'm going to keep bringing in this grain, I need to build bigger grain bins because I am so good at it. And what happens? He dies that night while he's sitting there thinking about it. And it's the same thing with him. All he was concerned about was himself, his money, and the whole idea is, if you got that much grain, why are you hoarding it? Why aren't you sharing it? And that's what Paul is saying here to Timothy in the part that we read about. He says he never criticizes wealth. What he criticizes is attitudes. And he says, what you got to do? And that's that whole thing about the greed. Don't be greedy. But he says, if you have, he said, there are some that have, and they are supposed to do four things. And before I get into those four things, you know, as we're talking about those that have and those that have not, I would venture to say almost everybody here is thinking the haves are somebody different. You know, you probably got somebody in mind when we talk about who the haves are, but we are all the haves. When you look at what's going on in our society, you look around the world, we are all in the haves. You know, I don't think that there's anybody in here that's missed a meal, didn't have a way to get here, didn't have clothes to put on, more than one set of clothes. And if you're like at our house, we've got, I don't know how many closets. Some of them are walk-in closets. I've got this much. But that's a whole different story. But we've got plenty of clothes, and we don't have to. We're not worried about eating and all of those things. And so we are the haves. Everybody in here, because if you have money in your pocket, at the end of the day, your half. And you're being blessed. And so, there's four things that we're supposed to be doing. First one is to be good. To do good. To share. And to be generous. Now, you know, sometimes those first two sound the same. To be good, do good. Because you kind of got to be good to do good. But when I read that, I always think back to my mom. We're getting ready to go out somewhere, you know, when I was in grade school, junior high, or whatever, and you're going out the door, especially if I was hooking up with Danny across the street. Her instructions were always, be good. But wait a minute, you're getting ready to go out. Wait. Stop the door. And she'd say, be good. And you know, I knew what that meant. I usually wasn't, but I knew what that meant. And I also knew there were consequences tied to it, and I got back home. But anyway, you know, because being good is different than doing good. You know, being good is about what's in here, and it's about what's in here. It's about making our attitudes and our spirits in line with God. Jesus says, only God is good. And so when Paul is saying, be good and do good, he's saying, emulate God. Try to have the same spirit and to have good thoughts, to have good intentions, to do all of those things together. Because that's where it's got to start. You got to have the right mind, the right attitude, the right spirit. And then he says, do good. And that is, you know, sharing God, doing the things God would have us to do around us. Sometimes that's just being simple and just doing good is something that we typically do with our hands, our feet, our mouths, and that thing. The way that we reach out to people, the things we do for people, the things we say to people, and all of that together. And so it starts with our attitudes. It moves to our immediate actions. What am I doing? Because the next two, you can do without ever being involved. When he says, share and be generous. You know, you can share, you can be generous to somebody without ever doing anything. You know, without just, and some people think that's all that there is. That all I got to do, if I can just, you know, send a check, send something, make a donation, then I'm good. And they don't ever do anything. So, you know, Paul says it's more important to be doing than it is even to be giving. But he says that we are to share. You know, that one of the principles of the Bible all along is that there are poor. There are some that aren't poor. And that it is the duty of those that are not poor to be watching out for those that are poor, and to do what we can. There's responsibilities on both sides, and you know, there are things in there about the working and not being loafers, but there's also things about he says even here, don't be arrogant, don't be snooty, don't be thinking I don't need to be involved in all of that. That's part of the being good and doing good. But also to share. You know, and in the two instances that Jesus told, they were about not sharing. And not sharing a lot, but not sharing at all. And all of us have enough that we can share. Share of what we do, share our time, share of the resources that we have. And then the last one is to be generous. I knew a friend that had two little boys, and they were cutting something in half. You know how it is when you got two kids, and you got one, and you got to split it between them, and it better be even. And it wasn't. One of them cut it, and it was about one third and two thirds. And so they're starting to bicker about it, because the one's not being one to be the one that was cut it. Of course, he's the one wanting to take the big share. And they're arguing back and forth. And so the mom thinking, this is a good time to make a good faith lesson. And so she says, you know, Jesus called us to be generous. How do you think Jesus would do? Don't you think Jesus would give the bigger share to somebody else? And the boys are both looking. She said, so what do you think? And one boy looked at the other. He said, you be Jesus today. And he took the big piece. So, you know, sometimes that's the way that we are. You know, and we don't think about, you know, I've got enough. There was enough in the third. Maybe the other person needs more. And so, you know, we are to share and not to take the whole thing, but to be generous in how we give. And to think about where can we give and what can we give. And I'll tell you, I'm also one of those that think, you know, some people think that everything you give has to be, you know, in the plate and in the church. But there are things to give here. There are things to give elsewhere. There are times that sometimes to give and to be generous is just digging in and handing something over, or going to swinging through a restaurant or bringing food to somebody, or cooking it yourself and taking it down there. Sometimes that, you know, it's about where we give and other ministries that are going on and the ways that we can jump in. You know, we read a little bit earlier that we believe in one church, of which United Methodist Church is a vital part, and that we're all one family. And so sometimes, you know, sometimes we join in one of those other family members and things that they're doing and things that are happening out there. But we always need to think about what I have and what I can do. Where can I be generous? Where can I share? A couple other things too. You know, in our United Methodist Heritage, John Wesley said, make all you can, save all you can, share all you can. And he said that, for him and his view, of course, he was pretty, you know, the way he lived as an Anglican priest was fairly meager, but he used to teach others, there's nothing wrong with making more money. Because if you make more money, it gives you more opportunities to share. Then you have more left over to be able to give. Now, he said, you need to take care of yourself first, and that's understandable. That's the save part. Make all you can, save all you can. You know, back then they didn't have Social Security and a lot of things like that. So save all you can, but then give all you can. Don't just give a little bit. Give what you can give. Look for those opportunities you can do those things. And we're told here, and Jesus even says it, you know, he says, and they both use the same language, and when you do those things, you know, you got two choices. You can try to store up your treasures here, your possessions, your resources, and all that. Or both Paul, taking his lead from what Jesus said in the Gospels, is when you give, you build up treasures in heaven. That you're making things better for yourself and you're actually getting more blessing, and that you gain more by giving than you do by holding. And, you know, so we need to think about those things and think about, you know, what we have. Who's in need? What can I give? How much can I give? Where do I need to give? I need to be good, to be doing good, and that means not just sending out gifts, but being involved in doing things for other people. And then what can I give, and am I giving generously? Am I giving, as Wesley said, all I can give, or am I trying to keep back? You know, and know that giving is something that is biblical, it's Christian. As a matter of fact, Christianity is by far out in front of all other faiths when it comes to giving and in charities and what goes out, not just from through the church, but also through other things as well. And so we need to be giving. We need to make a difference to those around us. We need to show the love of Christ by what we give, how we give, that we're trying to do and share so that God continues to bless us. So now let's stand and join our voices as we prepare to go out into the world. For his own, but I know whom I have believed. persuaded that he is able to keep me. I've committed unto him against that day. Let's pray. Father, we know that you are able to get us through whatever we have to go through. Lord, as we face this week, help us to see the opportunities that there are to be good, to share, to be generous, to look at those around us and to see who we can bless through your name. Lord, help us to always keep our focus on you and be content wherever we are in our lives, to know that you're with us and Lord, that you give to us so that we can give to others. And to help us in our witness in all that we do, that we might give of ourselves as we share our time, Lord, our caring and our gifts with those around us. And just, Lord, as we show them your love through the things that we do. So as we go out into this world, we ask that you will bless us, keep us, shine your light upon us and upon our path, Lord, that we might always walk in your ways. Help us to live according to your will, that others will see your good in us. For it's in Jesus' name that we go and we live and we pray. Amen.